welcome here. It's really nice to be back on campus and having been on. Great memories of our work we did around UC divestment from South Africa. We lived in tents for 3 months out in front of the quad there. And used to come sneak in here to shower before going to class. Great memories. I want to talk a little bit about how actually I came to this book, right? Because, you know, the title of the conference, Chemical Entanglements, and in many ways I ended up in this work because of those chemical entanglements. I was a women's health advocate working on breast cancer issues and ensuring that low-income women, underinsured and uninsured women had access to breast cancer services. And at that time, we were talking about mammography as prevention. And that is not prevention. It's a diagnostic tool, right, for early detection, but it's still not prevention. And in the course of that work, just had this, you know, sort of bug in the back of my head saying, why are younger women calling offices for services? Why are 35-year-old and 40- and 20-year-old women and being turned away, being told, don't worry, you don't have breast cancer, we're going to have this thing, right? Ended up hearing Sandra Steingraber speak, and if you haven't read her book, Living Downstream, that was the first time I learned about chemical contamination and body burn. And as a social justice advocate, it struck me as the height of injustice that these chemicals, it's a trespass, right? There's a chemical trespass and damage. And whether I get sick or not, it's still in my body and there are synthetic chemicals. And so that is how I ended up at PSR, Physicians for Social Responsibility, initially working to bring the health voice to battles around pesticides. But the more I worked in the movement, and I'm not a scientist, right? So I'm gonna go, you know, a little bit of science, a lot of policy, but a lot of movement politics. Because those are all enmeshed and entangled in ways that are really important in terms of the science that you do, who does the science, and whose interests you do the science, but also who's at the center of the policy and who benefits from the policy decision. So all of those are very, very entangled in the work that we do and how Physicians for Social Responsibility how our work and our thinking about the work has evolved. And that evolution is really personified in the work that we're now doing with Standing Together Against Neighborhood Drilling. So I came to the work pesticides from a toxics point of view, from a products point of view. You know, my early trainers and colleagues were amazing women in the environmental health movement. It's going to be set on this. Sorry about that. So I came to the work from this toxics perspective, and my early training was, you know, at that time we were talking about bisphenol A, we were just starting to talk about these issues of fragrance. And so we were also, as a movement, beginning to understand the role of endocrine-disrupting chemicals, and that this concept of dose-making the poison was wrong and different, and somehow that endocrine disruptors did not fit that model. And I came from a social justice background, so the more I learned about the reproductive and developmental impacts of these chemicals, from the heavy metals, to the synthetic chemicals, I was always rooted in the problems that I grew up seeing in my own community, right? From violence, lack of high school graduation, low birth weight, infant mortality. I kept seeing the things that I grew up in my community through the lens of these things that I was learning about as I had to teach myself about chemicals because I did not have that background. So I'm not a Mac person. I get it. I have a huge Mac fear, I don't know why. So over the last 15 years of working on toxics, we started again in that traditional toxics field, which ends up being a whack-a-mole. You know, we worked really hard to get rid of BPA in baby bottles, and we ended up with BPS, our evil cousin. We do not get better. And so this idea of regrettable substitutions, I kept getting more and more frustrated, right? And we passed this bill on baby bottles, and we worked 6 years on a bill that ended up not protecting who we're supposed to protect, right? Because women are the most vulnerable to the exposure of BPA. And if you actually want to protect children, don't know why I did that. Somehow women aren't worth protecting, right? In and of themselves, we are not worth protecting in the regulatory structure. So we thought, all this, you know, children, everybody loves children. So we ended up getting BPA out of baby bottles, but that actually doesn't protect babies or women, right? And that really frustrated, just getting these, you know, huge discussions in the office about what, you know, how do we approach this in a different way? And at the same time, you know, phone calls are coming into our office about contamination in communities, right? Whether that's oil drilling, whether that's lead poisoning, lead in soil. And that really led to this deeper partnership with environmental justice communities, which felt like home, right? I was from a social justice background. And I started to see the real differences in approaches from environmental health advocates versus environmental justice advocates. And while environmental health advocates said beautiful things like, let's move upstream, let's prevent harm, you know what, that's really hard to do. Yeah. And so, but often they wanted to do that with our faces. And what I mean by our faces are those of, you know, people of color, but also, you know, people who are living in the front lines, right? Who are deeply impacted because the production is happening, the disposal is happening, the use is happening there. And so there were these tensions that were movement tensions, but they're science tensions, and it's about gaze and focus, about where you're going to look for your policy. And so we started to say, you know what, we're going to, and our climate work was deeply climate justice work. So we said, let's rethink our toxics work. And so we're still in, you know, it's been about 2 years, and it's been a real huge shift, right? We said, let's start with the land. Let's start with where people live and what's next door to them. And so we do a lot of work now around land use and toxics and looking at industrial land uses in South LA in particular. And at the same time, because we had this long history of doing toxics work, a long history of doing climate work, well, you see how they're all together, right? And they're all based on this idea of petrochemicals and that the products that we use, you know, it was really hard to come here scent-free today, I have to say, right? And it's because you have to read every label and you know, for a long time I got really focused on products, and then when I got focused on land, I got less worried about what I was putting on, right? And so, but actually the picture that you're looking at is one of those stark moments when you realize I can spend a lot of time, and it's valid work and it's important work to get BPA out of products, to get flame retardants out of products. But you know what, those products end up somewhere, and we end up creating a dual market. Because for folks who are forced to live next to an oil drilling site, buying flame retardant free anything is a luxury. And so I wanted our toxics work to be deeply imbued with justice. So that has meant, you know, a rethinking of how we do work. And so that has led to our work, you know, this is what happens next to where people live. So they said this is steam, but the workers are covered up. We're not sure that's steam. And so that may or may not be a serious exposure. But for the communities who live there, who haven't gone to smoke school and don't know how to read that smoke, you're going to worry. Right? And so that's a level of a stressor in a community that we don't need. And so part of what was amazing about this work with standing together against the drilling was that we've forgotten the history of Los Angeles and that the city was not built by Hollywood. The city was built by oil and a struggle over water and natural resources, right? And that beneath most of where we live now is there's a spider web of oil infrastructure there. The first woman millionaire, Emma Summers, made her money on oil in the LA oil fields, which is now Echo Park. This is actually where I went to high school, Belmont, and there's fields there. And this is what our beaches used to look like. So this is the turn of the 1900s, and that's what it looks like now. The little insert in the middle, that's actually also sort of that Glendale Echo Park area that's not far from Belmont. So we forget this is what Los Angeles looked like. And those of us, you know, I came to the US in the 1960s, and there were still pump jacks in our neighborhoods, and they were open, they weren't hidden, right? But if you live in Wilmington, there's a McDonald's with a pump jack, there's a church with a pump jack, there's schools with a pump jack, in fact, there's hospitals with pump jacks. So this, but there's other parts of Los Angeles that said this is incompatible with human activity. So places like Santa Monica, Hermosa Beach, although, you know, they're still close to the refinery. So we can't forget it. It's oil. Oil, we have the entire life cycle of oil here, from pulling it in on the ground to taking it on trucks, trains, and pipes to the refineries and then back out. That entire life cycle is here. And what happens here in Los Angeles does not happen anywhere else. We pull oil out next to where people live and next to where a lot of people live, right? So it's different from what's happening in North Dakota, South Dakota, other parts where they're rural. While there may be one or two people nearby, near a well pad, here we're talking thousands. And we're you can see the kind of density. We have about, actually this is a little bit old, there's about 1,000 active wells in the city of Los Angeles, about 5,000 active wells throughout the county. And again, high density, majority of the people who live there are communities of color. And we're pulling up about, this is too small for me to read again, so about 24 million gallons of oil in Los Angeles. The next one is Bakersfield. The next largest producer is Bakersfield. And if you drive to Bakersfield, you will see fields and pump jacks. And those of you who love